And my guest on the classroom chat today is Neelakantha Bhanu Prakash. I should call you Bhanu, right?
Yes, absolutely, sir.
Okay, so let me introduce Bhanu. Bhanu is India's maths prodigy, or probably it will be more appropriate to say he's the world's maths prodigy. He has just won the first ever gold for India at the Mental Calculation World Championship at the Mind Sports Olympiad in London earlier this month. And there were about, 30 participants from 13 countries. Am I getting the number right?
Yes, absolutely. Perfect.
Okay. So, first of all, for those who are not familiar with what you did, tell us about this particular feat.
So, mind sports and mental calculation, the two words speak for themselves, right? Mental calculation is doing calculations here, and mind sports is to actually play games with this. So, I'm 20 years old, and I hold 4 world records and 50 IMCA records for being the fastest human calculator in the world, a title which I once held. I hold since a long, long time now, is when a mental calculator is someone who calculates quicker than the speed of a calculator. And this, in this, being the quickest is the title of what it means. And a few study records have shown that I calculated the speed of 12 numbers per second, which is 4 times and 4.5 times the average speed of a human being. And the recent task and the recent very big achievement which I've had is that I've taken part in the Mind Sports Olympiad, the Olympics. It's the equivalent, which was held in London. This time, yes. Corona, COVID time, it was held online with a lot of scrutiny and a lot of long runs. And the competition, as you mentioned clearly, with 30 people, 13 countries representing their own countries and things. And it's an open competition because the brain does not have an age. So there is there's people from 14 years of age till 57 years of age, adults who are from 57 years of age, taking part in this competition. And I won it for India for the first time. The competition has things like calculating cube roots, square roots, addition, subtraction, multiplication, some surprise tasks, exponents, and all of these. And the fundamental of this is not to use Abacus or Vedic math or any other method, but it's about agility of brain. Because using any of the other techniques sort of makes us take a vehicle to reach our destination when we want to get our muscles strong. So in that sense, I think that's what the feat is, to be the first Asian to have ever won the Mind Sports Olympics and bring it back home to India.
Fantastic. Now, most of our subscribers are students of class 9, 10, 11, 12, and they would be very keen to know from you, Bhanu, as to what tips that you can give them in order to excel in mathematics. Now, for the students, let me say it right on record that he scored a perfect 10 as far as his math scores in class 10 were concerned. In class 12, he had 300 on 300. So pretty much a model to emulate. Now, you don't have a calculator at home, do you?
No, I don't.
You don't have a calculator at home. And tell me something, for those who actually suffer from a phobia of mathematics, what would you tell them how to really make mathematics fun?
Okay, so the reason and something which I personally as an entity, if you follow my Insta feed or my Twitter feed or anything of that sort, @fastesthumancalculator or Exploring Infinity is the firm which I head. The fundamental goal is making math fun is the key to success in it. There is no way whatsoever that the phobia is away from you only because of your performance. Math gets harder and harder the more you know about it. And the only way you can sort of be in terms and peace and in love with the subject is when you start having fun. And how? Let me tell you. Yes, ideally, in a good scenario, your teachers, your parents, your systems should be encouraging you to do so. And that's something which I aspire to change with my startup and the courseware which we have called the Turn On The Computer and You, Math Wizard for a certain age group, imbibing a certain mathematical qualities and understandings as a kid. And in fact, we've even piloted out, for the people who are watching this, I think since they've told that they're 12th graders also, we're talking about, integration for six-year-olds, where you don't tell them that it's integration, but you tell them, dump it down to a level which they understand and check it. And they do. So people and kids are actually, you're gifted. Kids in general under the age of 15, under the age of 16, I would not call myself to be a part of it anymore, but are gifted in how good they can do in math. And this can be figured out by having fun with it. How? That's by looking at math, everything around you. I think that is the whole exercise. Thinking mathematically, let's say asking questions to yourself on, let's say when you're walking past a car and then you look at a number and then you say, is this car a prime car? And that's something which we did as a campaign where we had kids talking about prime cars and not prime cars, where you do four-digit factorization and try doing it in your head. And it's just, again, at the end of the day, why? It's because no one has to pose a question at you. The questions are all around you. I mean, you can try. And that's the beauty of the subject mathematics. You can make and draw connections between things which are not connected. So,
So basically you're saying that you are thinking of numbers all the time and you basically look at these kind of very practical ways to make it all fun. So, but in terms of, you know, the syllabus, the math syllabus, which may seem very daunting to a lot of students, what kind of practical tips would you give to those students in order to do as well in maths as you did when you were in class 10 and class 12?
So, again, I mean, that's a good question because, I mean, one, while it is open exploration of the open world exploration, which I think is a good precursor towards doing anything, exams and the way in which math play an important role in how you perform, not only in math, but also significantly other subjects which are dependent on it, is determined by how good you understand your concepts. And let me tell you why. I mean, I'm going to probably ask out a question here. What is 7 times 8? And I think I'm sure everyone is thinking 56 at this point of time. But that's because you've been told that it's 56. When I say 17 times 8, that's when you need to calculate. So what we understand is that, I mean, the point which I want to drive home is that to communicate and sort of implement a certain algorithm is easy. What is hard is to understand why it works. And and I mean, that is a question which I think we should ask at every interval of mathematical learning, be it 10th class, be it 11th, be it 12th. And this comes by spending time with it. For example, everyone knows about the Euclid's division algorithm. We look at the Euclid's division algorithm. We talk about the fact that R is always less than the quotient and the divisor itself because of multiple reasons and fundamental theorem of arithmetic flows. And I think you lost me already because every one of us have done 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th. But this is just the first chapter's second paragraph in class 10, which has way more impact than anything else. The reason is that have we spent that extra 2 minutes to understand where I can relate to this in the world around me? And if you do that, yes, it's a daunting exercise. Yes, it's a hard exercise to do. But once that internalizes, just imagine it's like Tetris game if you've played. It's the block fitting in the right spot. So, I mean,
while we're talking of students, but there are a whole lot of teachers also who are subscribers to this channel. What would you tell to those maths teachers who are out there who are kind of go by syllabus, chapter by chapter, concept by concept? How do they kind of make the whole process of teaching mathematics more fun, more engaging?
One, treat math as an art. That is something which I tell everywhere I go. Exploring Infinity is the firm which I head talks about fundamental reasons saying, why is math an art? It's because it requires skills which are beyond what a general scientific model does. It's not just open exploration and solving a problem, but creative ways of finding to do so. So one sincere request, which I give to every single teacher who's watching me anywhere in the world, is stop grading your kids on solutions. Mathematicians take pride in saying that we either mark you a 0 or we mark you a 5 on 5. There is no midway. We take pride in doing so and we should stop doing it. I mean, I did believe in it for a while, but the fact is that how many of us would grade an essay 0? We would not. We would dare not. Reason being that you will evaluate on a much more critical scale, talk about what form of punctuation lacks. In a similar sense, mathematical problems can be broadly categorized into buckets. Algebraic understanding, association, pattern understanding. And this is something which we observed. Exploring Infinity is the firm. We did experiments with kids doing algebra with question marks and stars as the variables, and they did significantly better. That's because of the phobia of alphabets coming up there. So this math is not just a science. I mean, it's not all notation and science. It's an art, and it has a lot of social implications. And the teachers have to be sensitive enough to understand and find the right ways to get uphill. I mean, Mount Everest can probably be climbed from 5 different angles. Every kid has his own route, and as long as we can customize the path of learning, kids are intelligent. Never blame the kids.
Right.
I mean, I'm on that side of edge when it comes to things.
So, I mean, just tell me about yourself, in the sense, are you a person who sees numbers in just about everything at any given point in time? Almost. I mean, how does your mind work? I'm just trying to understand how your mind works.
So, I mean, I use math as a good distraction tool. I use math as a good tool to sort of be concentrated on something. And let me tell you how. For example, I'm talking to you right now. It's been 783 seconds since we started talking. And probably even more. I'm not sure what goes on record, what doesn't. But still, it's been that long. And I mean, I'm talking to you right now, and I'm probably doing the table of 43 in my head. 43, 86, 129, 172, 215, 258. But I'm also communicating with you right now, and I'm at 473, 516, 559. So here, you see that math is a good tool to partition your brain. 860, 903, 946. So this is a way in which we can communicate and tell ourselves that math is a key to unlock the true brain potential. And this is something which I actively do. Am I going past a taxi? What is the taxi number? Yeah, 1720-1763 is where I am at that table, just coming back. So the taxi which passes by you, you the number of metro pillars you've crossed if you're living in a metropolitan, how many times did the other person speak and blink in this entire conversation? Or probably even to a certain extent, think of how much you speak versus how much the other person speaks to sort of understand if it's an equal conversation or not. So, I mean, in that sense, yes, there is a lot of things to look at into math. And yes, I do it constantly. Sometimes it's a little too much, but I mean, that's the way I function. So
lastly, I mean, do the dreams that you see in the night also, do they also kind of concern maths and numbers?
Not exactly. I mean, math and numbers are just two ways. For example, I personally see that mathematical thought is different from mathematics in general, like arithmetic. Like mathematical thought is when, I mean, you harness your brain. Let's just imagine your brain is, there's this guy inside your head who's actually going around, and there's a nail to which he's hooked. So he's going on free circles or whatever. So his motions are random, right? The motions are random. Mathematics is to keep these in pattern. I mean, there is a structural way in which you go about your thoughts and things like these. And so my dreams obviously are very organized. That is there. I mean, my dreams are very organized. They're very compartmentalized. And in a few senses, a very vivid in terms of, I mean, I had a dream the other day where I think 4 or 5 days ago, if I'm not wrong, where there were 16 dogs which went missing. And I mean, again, a lot of went missing is different from 16 dogs which went missing. So, I mean, I think maybe it's the brain ways of telling you that, hey, this is what you function, this is what you are. So, yeah, rub it in. So, yeah.
So now you are studying at St. Stephen's College in Delhi, Delhi University. What are your academic plans, say, in the next 4 to 5 years?
So I finished my graduation right now in COVID time. I've written my exams online, and I wish to go for a master's and a postdoctoral study sometime later. But I want to give a couple of years of break, work on exploring infinities. In fact, everyone, I mean, a call out to every one of you here who thinks that they want to experience math. Not really, I mean, at the end of the day, the goal is never to excel exams. I mean, the goal should be to excel exams, yes. But the reason why we start studying should not be them. I mean, if it is that, then we are giving it a lesser thing than the other much more serious thing is saying that I want to learn what I am supposed to learn. And that should be the hunger and the way ahead. So exploring infinities is, I think, what I'm going to be working for the next 2 years, doing courseware, teaching people and getting people in. And after that, subsequently, a master's and a postdoctoral study in mathematical research. Great.
I wish you all the best. It has been an absolute pleasure interacting with you, listening to you. Maths definitely not my strong point all through my school years. So it's a pleasure to listen to someone who is an absolute maths wizard. My best wishes to you. Thank you very much for your time.
Yeah, thank you.